Good morning, everybody. Thank you for coming. This is the first one of the 2017, first workshop of 2017. But as I was preparing for this workshop, I looked back, and this is actually fourth year that we're doing this. So this is about 16th or 17th session that we had. And we couldn't have that without your support and continue to come here and participate in it. So thank you as well for coming and supporting this. Hopefully today will be also something that you consider worth your while. So we'll cover a few topics today, mainly about energy efficiency opportunities, to everybody's surprise. We'll talk about how to find some of them. We'll talk about how to turn them into the action. And we'll talk about something that I call three R's. Reduce, recycle, and then replace. So hopefully you'll find this interesting. If you have any questions along the way, if you have any suggestions, if you want to share some of your stories, please feel free to do so. So for those of you who have been here, this is not going to be a surprise, but I think it's important to mention where we come from so that you don't think that we speak without any experience. We have helped our customers save 110 million cubic meters of natural gas. 110 million, that's a lot of gas. But also we helped identify more than 20 million kilowatt hours of electricity and over 800,000 cubic meters of water in a three-year period alone. We've been doing this for over 20 years. So there is a certain experience, certain amount of knowledge that we gained working with you that we're willing to share, that we're willing to help others also save energy with. How we do that? We do it through the program that's tailored to the customer. We call this industrial custom program, and it's truly a custom program. It offers a customized solutions to use energy as efficiently as possible. And everybody thinks that energy efficiency must mean use less of something. That's not necessarily true. You can use exact same amount, but if you increase your production at the same time, you're still doing energy efficiency. Actually, we would prefer that. You would prefer that, probably. Rather than cutting back alone, why not use what you use already, but more smartly to achieve more? That's also energy efficiency. We have, as Isabel has mentioned, we have seven energy solution consultants who take care of our large industrial customers, and we have an energy solutions consultant who is dedicated to the small industrial customers as well. So we have this personal interaction between our energy consultants and your technical staff or yourself. And all of that is to say that we work with the customers to uncover and support initiatives in your facilities. So it's not just about we finding opportunities or you finding opportunities, it's that interaction between you and us. We are experts in energy efficiency, you are experts in how your plant operates, you are experts in your processes. Put together, you get excellent solutions that will save energy for your facility. So we don't have any prescribed notions of what needs to be done. We ask for you to tell us what your pain points are in your facility, and then we work around those pain points and integrate energy to find energy solutions. And we do that through a process that's very similar to what most of you know as a continuous improvement. So we start with the knowledge development. We go through the identification of opportunities. And then continue with quantification of opportunities. It's not just enough to identify opportunity. Everybody can say you can save here, there, and everywhere. How much is that savings worth? Is it worth my investigation? Is it worth the hassle of changing something once you actually implement it? We provide engineering analysis as well to analyze the data, to say what is this data telling us for your particular facility. And all in the hopes that eventually you will do action and implement the projects that we were talked about. That's the ultimate goal. All these previous activities are all good. They all lead to more knowledge. They all lead to more, if you will, awareness of your facility, but they don't actually save anything. Action and implementation of the projects is where the savings happen. Without that step, there is no savings. So how do we get involved in all these steps? Knowledge development. You receive our quarterly newsletters through the email. We have a web portal where you can find things like these workshops that are filmed, and then you can view them at your leisure. We put up the case studies. We have calculators that you can use, some of the simple savings that you can get an idea what it would be worth it. On the opportunity identification, we work with you. to find opportunities. But if you work with a third party that does the same thing that you prefer, or that you think they're better experts in the field, feel free to engage them and we'll cover up to 50% of the cost for those that are eligible under our program. Same goes for opportunity quantification. We can help you quantify some of the opportunities, but if you need more detailed analysis, if you need gas meters, if you need to know how much your facility is using, feel free to contact us and we can get you up to 50% of the cost of, say, meter recalibration or meter hookup to your system or whatever it is that you need to be comfortable that the project will get you the savings that you think it's going to get. I mean, in this step alone, if one thing that I've seen over and over is people try to save on water heating. And usually they overestimate how much water they actually use. So if you put water meter on and have it for a week of the typical production, you will be certain of how much water you use and how much energy you're going to save. So why not do that step? Engineering analysis goes the same thing. We can provide a pretty good engineering analysis ourselves. So all seven of my energy solutions consultants are engineers. They're all professionals in their field. They all know what they're talking about. But if you have specific requirements, very specific to your process, and you work with some consulting company for years and years who knows your process inside out, feel free to engage them and we'll cover up to 50% of the cost, again, for those that are eligible. And finally, action and implementation. This is the meat of the program. And this is where you get, on top of all the other incentives, you get an incentive for annual cubic meter saved. So if you save 100,000 cubic meters annually for your project, you will get 20 cents for the first 50,000 cubic meters and 5 cents for every cubic meter thereafter, or up to 50% of the project costs. So it's a pretty good incentive for something that will also save you money as you do it. So, first things first, why do it? Why would you worry about energy efficiency in your facility? And for most of you, that will be self-evident. That's why you're here, because you show interest in that, because this is of interest to you. But I'm not sure that that can be said of everybody in your organization, and I'm certainly not sure that it can be said of every one of the organizations in our service territory. So what is it in the organization? When you explain to somebody why energy needs to be saved, what's the benefit of it? I, for example, never talk about energy. Energy is the last thing I talk about. What I talk about is, why do we win jobs? Why do manufacturing facilities exist? Right? Because we have something that others don't have. We have either unique process to make something, we have really good marketing and we can sell it, we have really good sales, we sell our product, but there's a reason why somebody wants to buy our product. And that reason is a benefit that you bring to the marketplace. Your product has a benefit to it. On the other hand, to be competitive, you can have all the benefits you want. If you're not competitive, if you're not controlling your operational costs, you will not be cost effective. If you don't bring cost advantage to the marketplace, you again won't be successful. So the combination between the benefit and the cost at which you bring that benefit to the market is your value proposition. This is why people buy products from you. This is why this happens. Because your value proposition is better than your competitors. So let's look at the energy. You can reduce operational costs in any number of ways. You can argue over the labor cost, you can argue over the cost of the inputs of the raw materials. One other way is to reduce your energy consumption or use your energy smarter, better. So better KPI on the product of an energy. That reduces the cost. Reducing the cost increases your cost advantage. But unlike any other savings in operational costs, energy consumption reduction also reduces your carbon footprint, improves your public image, and in most cases will increase the enhance working conditions, which all means that energy efficiency, energy consumption reduction actually increases your value proposition to the marketplace. This is the only operational savings that does impact both sides positively. This is how I always explain energy efficiency to anybody in the accounting, for example. Because they don't care how many BTUs I save. They don't care how cool the new equipment is that's going to give me energy efficiency. This is what I care about. So where do I find these energy efficiency opportunities? And those who have participated in these workshops for a while now know that we've talked about many different areas. So this one, I thought, let's recap some of those things. Let's go through the whole facility. Rather than focus on one technology, let's go through the whole facility. Let's give us some ideas. And maybe those ideas are not exactly what you can implement, but I bet you that the genesis, the principle behind it can be applied to any facility in Southern Ontario. So we talked about three R's. Every time we do this, the first step should always be reduce or avoid your heat losses if you can. This is the first step. There is no point in making heat losses as 100% efficient if they're losses to begin with. The second step is, if you cannot avoid some waste heat, recover it. Again, don't let the heat go up the stack. Don't let the heat go out of the facility without being used if it can be used and you need it. And third, and only last, smallest piece of this pyramid of the energy efficiency is replacing the equipment. As budget allows, as your competitive pressures demand, replace the equipment with a more efficient one. Don't do like for like if you can avoid it. But that should be the step three. That should be the last step. A, because not all of you will have access to capital funding all the time. And there's, again, I stress this over and over. There's no point in making something very, very efficiently if you don't need it. That still means it's a waste. So let's take a look at the facilities. So let's take a look at some of the areas where the energy is used. Some of it will be used in your process equipment. Process ovens, paint lines, all that good stuff. Some of it will be used in the energy converters, air compressors or boilers. Things that convert one sort of energy to another. Make up air units and space heaters. Those are the basically four elements where the thermal energy is used in the facility when you look at a big scale. And all of them have distinct ways that the energy is used, times, and amounts of energy. But without doing a basic analysis, you will not know where your energy is going. And I see this over and over again. I see customers replacing the pieces of equipment that use the least amount of energy, and they're spending the same amount of money they would have spent on something that they can save them a lot more. So when you think about it, what it drives the thermal energy consumption in your facilities? Where are the thermal energy users? Broad stroke, you can divide them into seasonal users and the process users. Seasonals are the ones that will be dependent on the outdoor air. The colder it is, the more energy they use. Process is something that happens all along the year. Even in the middle of the summer, you will use the same amount of heat in that process piece of equipment. Do not confuse seasonal with heating, and we'll get to that later. So how do we analyze this? Again, something that you guys have seen before, but natural gas consumption profile, put 3 years worth of data average each month for the last 3 years. Do the graph like this. Draw the line over the summer months where you know that heating is not included in this. That gives you your basic process load. This is your process load of your facility. Multiply by 12 months, that's it. Cubic meters per year, broad strokes. And I know that will not apply to everybody even. You have to understand what your process is. But to start, this is a good start. The rest of it is all what we call seasonal load. And in this case, you will see that seasonal load is much bigger than the process load. For others, that will be opposite. But unless you do that basic analysis, you will not know where the energy is going. You might think you know. But this gives you a certainty. This gives you a feel that, yeah, something I'm going to do will affect it. So I mentioned that seasonality and heating are not the same things. It would seem that seasonal end users are all neatly defined, right? We can always say, oh, seasonal use, that's makeup air and space heaters. Good. And then process, of course, it's my process equipment. It would seem that way. The problem is that process load is also can be a seasonal load. And especially your makeup air. It's all process load. I know it's hard to believe, but your makeup air is actually tied to your process. So two examples of the process-dependent seasonal load. Can somebody think of one of the examples? If you have outdoor tanks and you have to keep them at the temperature, colder it is outside, the more energy you need into those tanks. The other one is paint booths. I know you guys shake your head, yeah. But I can tell you from experience, for those who don't know, we have a couple of people here who are very familiar with this, but for those who don't know about paint, this is a huge source of energy use. This is not like 5 cubic feet per minute that they have to process. They process hundreds and hundreds of thousands of cubic feet of air every minute. And if your air comes in at minus 30 degrees and you have to heat it to 70 degrees, that is a lot of energy. It's seasonal, but it has nothing to do with the heating of the place, of the building envelope. So even if you insulate your building and you say, now my heating is going to go down, that won't do anything for this. Zero. So where do we look for opportunities on the seasonal side? Where do we look for opportunities in general in the industrial facility? And there are exceptions to this, but by and large, for industrial facility, we really can eliminate the space heaters unless you've done everything else in the facility, because that's going to be your smallest user, and focus on two other things, makeup air and process equipment. And we'll explore both of them today. And I know from our past workshops when we talked about the process heating, people get really antsy about, I don't want to change my process. We're not trying to change the process. And we'll get to that a little bit later. So where do we start when we want to talk about makeup air, right? We know that the role of ventilation manufacturing facility is very specific. You do not need ventilation. You do not need makeup air in the facility unless you're exhausting some of that air out through your process. The only reason you do that is to ensure that the air that you exhaust is made up and the indoor air quality is good enough. So your makeup air should always, always, always be tied to your process that drives the need for makeup air. When that process is done, makeup air should be done. Makeup air is not source of the energy for your space heating. If you have makeup air and you've done a good thing and you chose the most efficient one, which is direct fired makeup air unit, now the code requires you to actually tie some exhaust to that makeup air unit because they don't want that product of combustion from the burner to be hanging around and adding into the building space. So you have to exhaust roughly the same amount of air that you're bringing in through the direct fire burner out through the roof. If you do that, what happens? If you use makeup air, and I've seen this, I've seen customers use it, makeup air as a space heating. Now they have to introduce exhaust that they never had in the building. So instead of just making up the energy that was lost through the walls, now you have to make up energy that's lost through the walls and all the energy that you pump into the air with the direct makeup air. That's one of the reasons, that's a key reason why using makeup air as space heating is a bad idea. If your process doesn't run, if you have no indoor air quality, shut off the makeup air. There's no need for it. Don't heat the building with it. It's expensive. It's costing you huge amounts of money. And I can preach to that, I can talk to it, and it still happens all the time. So, to repeat this, on the building, we have a bunch of exhausts. You're very familiar with those. There are some on the roofs, there are some on your ovens, they're spread all over the place. Exhaust volume that goes into the building has to be made up somewhere. So it's either made up through the makeup air volume, which nicely pre-warms that air, or the rest, if there is more exhaust than there is makeup air, cold and infiltration air goes into the building. And no matter how you spin it, you cannot prevent this cold air coming into the building as long as your exhaust and makeup air volumes are not balanced. So exhaust volume is the driver to your energy consumption on the makeup air side, always. So if you know that the exhaust volume is a function of the process requirements and indoor air quality requirements, then you know the makeup air volume is a function of your exhaust volume, not the other way around. And then when you face yourself with a building that's unbalanced, where you have lots of exhaust, you don't have enough makeup air, and lots of people will come into your building and say, ha, you need more makeup air. But think about that, do you? Because that would be true. That's one way to balance the building. Only if you need the exhaust that you're running. And I can speak, we've been doing now these air balance studies, we supported it, we talked to people who do them. For the last 5 years, I can tell you I didn't find one facility where they actually had lack of exhaust. In all, 100% of them, we could actually turn down the exhaust volume. So let's do a first exercise. Sure. Every single one of them, by a large amount. And I will get to one of the examples later, but let's see what is it worth. You know how we talk about, you can talk to your management, you can talk to your union representatives, all you want about how this is a bad thing, but what is it worth it? Because they'll say, well, that's not that expensive anyways. So let's see how much is it. We'll have 40,000 CFM of makeup air that will heat from the typical outdoor temperature in Toronto from 38.4 degrees F to 70 degrees F. We'll put some static pressure of 0.5 inches of water column that runs 6,048 hours a year, and we'll have direct fired makeup air efficiency of 0.91. These are the formulas that are in your workbook that you can use for natural gas side and for electricity side. One thing to remember, every time you can turn down the number of CFMs you put into the building, you also save electricity, not just thermal energy. And it's a direct relationship. If you cut 40,000 CFM down to 20,000, you save half of the electrical energy and thermal energy of your makeup air. And you would be surprised how much that can add up to. Couple of notes on these results is that I used very conservative static pressure in the unit. So your facility will probably actually have more savings in kilowatt hours than I put there. Because I measured them as high as 5 inches of water column in the exhaust and the makeup side of it. So that would be 10 times that. The other thing is $63,000 plus this, that's about $65,000, $66,000 to run 40,000 CFM air. So the point of this exercise is to say makeup air is expensive. And how expensive it is, even at the good numbers, 25 cents per cubic meter of natural gas and 12 cents per kilowatt hours, that amounts to about $1,680 for every 1,000 CFM of air you run. That adds up very quickly. So I urge you to talk to us, call us in, talk to us before you purchase new makeup air unit, before you do something, because we can help you either with the study financing or with the advice or with the third party independent analysis to say, you have too much exhaust, you don't have lots of air.
Yes?
No, it's not, not at all. That doesn't include it. That's just straight cost. As I said, even I don't know how many of you pay 12 cents per kilowatt hours, all that stuff. It is expensive, the point is. So why do we want to reduce exhaust volumes? Well, usually you have in your facility, you have process that requires makeup air. So your exhaust oven that you installed needs to process 10,000 CFM of air from the floor, which means you have to put 10,000 CFM of air into the facility through your makeup air. That's all good. But what happens over time, that process equipment generates a lot of heat. For anybody who's ever stood next to the process equipment that uses thermal energy, you know how hot it is in the immediate vicinity of the equipment. So what happens, people are hot. They're especially hot in the summertime. Easiest way to deal with that, rather than people walking out on, out of the workplace, or even worse, fainting there, is to put some roof exhaust to get rid of that heat. That's good for the summertime, because that extra exhaust draws some air from the outside. Now those people don't feel as hot. Situation is resolved. Problem is, then comes the wintertime, and those exhausts still run. So now you have three times as much exhaust than you do of makeup air. And as we said, balance has to be established one way or the other. So what happens is there is a rush of cold air coming from every possible angle, usually through the shipping door because those are areas that are opened. So that's the easiest place for air to enter. So the guy next to the shipping door is cold. It's freezing. Again, we resolve the problem rather than looking at underlying issue. Guy is cold, let's put some heat on it. We put usually infrared heaters or air curtains or some such thing. The problem is that that cold air continues going right through the facility and creates drafty and cold environment. So now you have to make up all sorts of heating equipment in the building to try to heat the building. And you say, we need it. This is absolutely necessary. So solution number one, as I mentioned, infrared heaters. But what do infrared heaters do? They have radiant heat. Radiant heat heats what? Objects. Air is not the object. Therefore, cold air just rushes by there. And the guy next to it, when you're standing right underneath the radiant heater, you're nice and warm. The guy 10 feet behind you is still freezing cold. So now you increased your energy use, both electricity and gas, and you didn't solve any problems whatsoever. So on its own, technology is very good, but how it's applied makes a difference. Another potential solution that people do is, oh, we have air filtration, we'll put some dog seals on it. Yes, that's fine, because that's one of the major sources of air infiltration. Problem is, if you don't close all of them, you will just increase infiltration in the other place where you didn't close it off. Because air has to be made up, one way or the other. Air will find a way. So for example, if you have four shipping doors and you insulate three this year because that's all the money you have, all you've done is you made a really fast airflow through the fourth door. Air curtains is another popular solution. Again, good technology, often misapplied. Air curtains work on the principle that they will stop the air infiltration by blowing the curtain of air from the top down to the bottom of the door. So air goes through it, stops the air infiltration. Good theory, works if your building is balanced. If that airflow over here is relatively manageable in small. But if you're over-exhausting, your input on air is not small and manageable. It's very large. So what happens, it just goes past, because it actually has more power than it does the air curtain that you put on. Again, waste of energy. Even in the best cases, effectiveness of the air curtain is actually 75%. So when we do calculations, when most vendors do calculations, they will say it's 75% effective to start with. And that assumes balanced building and drops off from there. So the real solution, if you really want to solve the problem of the cold, drafty air, is to really look at the balance of your building. Real solution is to get building balanced, and that you can only do by managing the exhaust volume. That's the only solution to it. I know it's complex. I know it can sometimes cause concern with your employees because they're like, oh, I don't know if the air quality is going to be good. That's why there are air quality tests that you can do before and after. Show them that they're not affected. This is the question that we always run into. I need the exhaust volumes. This, Steve has asked me earlier, this is common in our service area. Over-exhausting 150,000 CFM or more is common. I have two facilities right now in our service area that I know they can save 150,000 CFM today. So this is nothing that is uncommon. This is not one-off. This is 90% of our service territory. And all of them have reasons why do they need that exhaust. Every single one of them. But when we do the study and we find there is no reason to have exhaust, they still don't want to do it. They still don't want to reduce it for whatever reasons. So this is one of the things that we fight all along. And this is why it's so important to quantify the amount of energy used in these units. 150,000 CFM is worth $252,000 annually. And that's a conservative number that doesn't take into account the carbon cost, that doesn't take into account more than 12 cents per kilowatt hours, that doesn't take into account more than 25 cents per cubic meters. That's a conservative number. So every time that facility that can save 150,000 CFM is actually saying, I don't want to put $300,000 back into my pocket. And usually, to do this, to reduce your exhaust by 150,000 CFM, costs you, at a very high end, very luxurious, very good system, will cost you $100,000. In the simplest of cases, you can just go on the roof and turn off the exhaust. And it still doesn't happen. So one of the asks that I have for you guys is go back to your facilities. Take a look at your facility. See if there is potential for doing something. Call us in. Let's do a business case for you. Let's present business case to your management. Let's say, this is how you can save energy. Lots of people will say, my costs are high. My labor cost is high as Ontario. $300,000 sitting on the table. So now we'll talk about a little bit of the process heating. We talked about makeup air. Now let's turn our attention a little bit on the process heating side. And this is going to be very basic. Again, we're not trying to change the way you run your processes. When you look at heating efficiency, and heating efficiency is what you're paying for, really, is the ratio between the minimum heat required to meet your quality requirements and energy we invest into the process. Basic math. In simplified form, you can write this as the heat to load divided by the gross input energy. That's all heating efficiency is. And the goal of heating efficiency should be to reduce the amount that we invest into the process, keep the same heat to load because that's what you need for the quality of your process, and you increase your heating efficiency. So every time we talk about side that touches the product, we don't touch that. We actually maintain that. We want to reduce the input you put into the system. So, in a simplified format, product needs some heat to do it. In this case, this is a paint line. You need to put your product, your powder paint that's been painted onto the product through the line at, say, 20 minutes at 375 degrees F. That's the heat that needs to go into the load to make your product quality requirement. And for that, you put some gross input energy into this. You have to put natural gas and electricity into the oven to get that heat. But you have all these things around the way. You have some energy that's stored into the oven. You have some opening losses. You have some losses through the material handling, shell losses, and some exhaust losses. So the only way you can actually do a fair comparison of how your heating efficiency works is to do a proper energy balance. And by proper doesn't mean complex. But you have to put things on the paper. You have to make sure that it makes sense. So energy streams, all those streams that we put on there that are not heat to load are losses, every single one of them, because that's not going into your product. It's going into everything else. Some of them may be needed, but they're still losses. So you have opening losses. Those are the losses that, for example, in the oven, you have openings on the oven bigger than you need them, so the air goes, warm air goes out of it. You have material handling losses that are often overviewed, and those are the, when you have chains, for those of you who are familiar with the paint line ovens. You have chains that go through the paint line oven constantly, and then you hang stuff that you paint. That chain actually heats up and cools down every time you go through the facility. And believe it or not, for most of our general manufacturing, those chains take about 10 times the energy than the product that they are heating. And every time, this is very common, everybody says, oh, nothing changed. I'm running without the product and with product, no, my energy didn't change. Of course it didn't change, because your product is not the driver of the energy. It's all the other losses that are driving the energy. Exhaust losses is another one. Shell losses, you're all familiar, yes? Oh, yeah. Yeah. Yeah, none of them do that.
No, I mean, they can still come back and say that, oh, my bearings burn up all the time.
For sure, yeah.
Above the oven, and it turns out it's the hook that's hanging the product in the bake
oven
that's actually conducting heat up and cooking the bearings.
Yep.
It's not the actual air convecting it up.
Yeah. It all depends how you have it set up. That's the case. For example, for us, we had a process where we would have infrared section in front of the thermal section, and that would heat everything regardless what it is. And then we had to burn off the excess paint. We actually just had an open burner that was blowing onto the chains. That heats up the chain pretty quickly. So shell losses, you're all familiar with those, where you stand next to the oven and it's hot. You know, boilers, blowdown losses. So there's all these losses. Those are and those losses actually represents more energy than the product, than the heat that goes to the load. So when we talk about heating efficiency and improving on that, we want to minimize those. We don't want to change the process. We want to minimize those losses. Cover the openings if you don't need them. Many people have started with the paint lines, with the process lines that are made for the product that's 2 feet by 2 feet. Now they do the product that's 3 inches by 3 inches, and they still have large openings. Close the openings if you don't need them. Maintain or increase the insulation on your oven. There's lots of ovens that I see that have a gap of about an inch between the panels over time that developed. Close those. Maximize the loading of the conveyors. Don't run the conveyors empty. If the line doesn't run, stop the chain. Use different material transfer belts. This is very common on an ovens that, for example, transfer something on the belt. Do belt from the material that's not as heat absorbing. Instead of steel, use some plastic material if you can. Reduce the operating temperature. This is another thing that people say, I cannot do. But you walk by most of the paint ovens in the general manufacturing, most of them will run at least 20, if not 100 degrees higher than they need to. Because over time, the air balance inside the oven has changed so much for the lack of maintenance that they need to add more heat rather than improve the air flow inside the oven itself. So we have places where they run 375 degree oven at 450 degrees F just to maintain the quality of the product. And last, minimize the exhaust volume. I put it last because the next example will actually be talking about the exhaust volume and how much this is worth. But this is the one that I would focus the most. Just like general exhaust, exhaust on most of the general manufacturing ovens today is too high. So for example, for class A natural gas convection oven, which is the paint line oven, for example, finishing line oven, you need to, by the TSSA rules and by the NFTA rules, you have to have purge cycle on your oven. And purge requirement of the class A oven is that exhaust volume must enable 4 times the volume of the oven to be purged before the burner is lit. So what that means is that people generally have very high purge volumes because they don't want to wait for their oven for like an hour and a half before they can light it up. They want a 5 to 10 minute turnaround. So what happens, the purge volumes are very high. Exhausts are very high for the purge requirement. But when you actually do analysis of what you need once you're running it, operational requirements, you get much smaller amount of exhaust that's required, even at the full load of your oven. So how do we get from there to there? Today we look at that and we say, well, of course, you put fan VFD. Well, VFD only 20 years ago was a very expensive thing to do. So if you have oven 20 or more years old, and this is most of our finishing line ovens these days in our service territory, you don't have VFD. So what happens is you constantly run purge required exhaust volume on your oven, constantly. If you put VFD, you can have actually two modes, fully allowed by TSSA. You can have purge mode, and you can have regular production mode. Now, regular production can be either you can calculate it and submit calculations to TSSA, or you can have lower explosion limit sensors in the oven, and then that controls it. Either way, this is significant reduction that you can achieve by doing that. And how significant? We'll do another example right now, and then after that, we'll go for a break. So this time we have an oven that has 3.5 MMBTUs, million BTUs per hour burner. It has solvent load of 1.4 gallons per hour, which means there's so much solvent in the paint that needs to be exhausted out of the oven, and that's a fairly high load. You have operating temperature of 370 degrees, ambient temperature of 70 degrees, where the oven gets the air from. We measured the exhaust at 5,495 actual CFMs. Runs 4,500 hours at 91% efficiency. And you'll see in formulas later, this is correction factor to get from 70 to 370 degrees F in density. It's 1.57. Again, you will have these formulas. So standard volume of air for combustion reasons is 183 times your burner rating. Your actual volume of the same is just that standard times correction factor. And that solves the combustion issue. Then you have turnover air. That's another air requirement in your oven, which is calculated based on your solvent load. And this is what your oven really needs, this combination of combustion and turnover air. So if you calculate that, and you calculate the difference between the two, you will get to the point where you can calculate what is the different energy between using purge cycle exhaust volumes all the time and using volumes that you actually need as approved by TSSA. So to recap, we had about 5,500 CFM of air out of that exhaust. We only needed 1,200. So that's a reduction of 4,200 CFM of that oven without affecting any of your process. 4,000 CFM of air in actual is about 2,700 standard cubic feet per minute. 2,700 standard cubic feet per minute of air heated by 300 degrees F results in about 120,000 cubic meters of gas used annually for 4,000 hours. 4,000 hours is not a very high load oven. And this is very small. 5,000 CFM oven is very small finishing oven. It's not large. This represents about 20-25% of the energy use of the whole paint line building. So you're talking significant savings with no effect on your product whatsoever. We ran an actual campaign a couple of years ago based on this. We actually paid full load for the TSSA calculations. So if you had consultants to do the TSSA calculations for you, we would have paid the whole analysis, which was about $2,000, and we gave you incentive on the savings. And only three facilities in Ontario actually took us on in our service area. And just to give you an idea, we calculated this particular oven, but there's a company down in the States, George Cook, that does nothing but the paint lines and finishing lines. They actually did analysis a few years ago when I worked with them, when we were buying paint line from them. They did analysis for the whole of North America for their marketplace. This is what they found. For the finishing line, if you take 100% of your input energy, these are average losses on the 16% through the shell, 0.5% in an opening losses on a properly designed oven, 17% on the material handling. Most people will worry about this one before they will worry about that one. They found that the product requires only 22% of the overall energy, and 44% of the energy goes up the stack. The average for, and these are very large suppliers of the finishing oven. They have hundreds of installations. So these are not small sample analysis. This is the situation. You can almost count that your oven works exactly the same way. So 44% of all the energy that you pay for goes up the stack. So if you can just cut your exhaust in half, and that's almost a given, you will save 22% or more of your energy consumed by a finishing oven. 22%, one quarter. So if you want to consider that, if you want to look at the possibilities for your particular place of work, let us know. We'll come out, we'll help you out, we'll pay for somebody to do the analysis if need be. We have a person on staff that has worked on finishing ovens for most of his life, so he knows how to calculate it. We have access to the TSSA if you need it, that we can get them to approve your calculations. We have all these resources. You just have to contact us. Another thing that that calculation didn't take into account is that most paint shops today, because of the advances in the paint, in the paints that they use, powder paints, don't actually have any solvent in their paint. And they still exhaust like they did when they had a bunch of solvent in the paint. They never change that because that's just the way the paint needs it. What Darren mentioned, my burners are set up for that. There is no way I'm going to change it no matter what. Well, that's all good. But is it not at least worth your while to investigate it and investigate it properly rather than ask the maintenance guy whose only interest is to adjust that burner all the time? That, I believe, is worth the investigation. We talked about the losses on the exhaust, on the finishing oven, at the exhaust level. And what that is, oven is essentially an end user of it, right? But when you really think about it, that heat to load that oven is delivering to the product and the losses along the way happen all along your distribution chain, everywhere, from the meter on, through the energy converter, through the distribution system, all the way to the end user. So for example, at an energy converter level, at the boiler, steam boiler, typical steam boiler will have 76% efficiency if you don't have any economizers on it. So that means that 24% goes everywhere into the losses. About 3% blowdown, 20% in exhaust loss. And you have to remember, the further back you go, the more those heat losses are apparent. Because if you have to deliver 100 BTUs at the end product, and you have losses everywhere along the way, you have to deliver more at the meter level. So a significant amount of energy that you put, that you pay for, actually never gets used. It gets converted into the losses. So how can we help on the steam boiler, for example? We talked about the process oven, but what about the steam boiler? So obvious ways, minimize the blowdown, maintain or increase the insulation. Exhaust volume, another one. We said 20% goes up the exhaust. Well, on a well-maintained boiler, you don't have an option like we did on a finishing oven where you can just shut and close down your exhaust. That just doesn't work on the boiler. Boiler has to have that exhaust. So we have to now shift our strategy on energy efficiency. So instead of just reducing it, now we have to shift to recovering the heat. Now we say there's nothing we can do about that. We have to recover it. So if you think about it, what we say about heating efficiency, that it's heat to load divided by input energy. recovering is nothing else but recovering some of that energy, putting some of the loss back into the system, thus reducing your input energy. And that increases your heating efficiency. That's all it is. You're taking this energy that would have gone up the stack, and you're putting it back into your system. You're reducing the losses, you're increasing your heating efficiency. For flue gas, that's economizers. Most of you are familiar with the feed water economizer. Some of you are even familiar with condensing economizers. Combined, they will save you about 15% of your energy input into the boiler. Blowdown heat recovery, another one that some people know about. Most of the medium-sized to small-sized boilers don't use any blowdown heat recovery, and they blow down all the time. Condensate return. If you can, return as much as feasible back to the boiler. That still has some value. You don't have to use all the water, and you don't have to heat it all the time as high as you would otherwise. So again, our guys have seen this many, many times. They're coming to your facility when you want them, and they can discuss options with you and give you ballpark estimates on what you're going to save before you actually have to put any money in. So when you go and ask for the funding, you can ask with some level of certainty and some level of numbers, what are you going to get in return? So feed water economizer, as I said, most of you are familiar. For those who are not, feed water economizer essentially is relatively inexpensive to implement. You can put it onto your stack, and you just get some of the heat out of it. Both heat source and heat sink are functionally related because feed water economizer, as the name implies, preheats the feed water into the boiler. So as the boiler operates, that feed water is being preheated with the exhaust from that same boiler. Savings are about 3 to 5% of the boiler consumption. You can't get any more than 5%. Typical numbers are around 4%. The problem with the feed water economizer, even though it's inexpensive, it's relatively simple to implement and operation is very simple, we are leaving some of the heat in the stack. For example, because it's a feed water economizer, we can condense anything in there. The reason we can condense then drives the temperature of exhaust. About 300 degrees F is where you want to be at the minimum, which means you can't use any other water than the feed water because anything else would condense the fluids, the moisture out of the exhaust. So you're forced to use feed water as your cooling agent in the feed water economizer. And that means that that's the only viable heat sink for that operation. This condensing economizer, just like you mentioned, is typically installed offline. There are some that are in stack, but those are minority. They're installed offline, which means that you can feed more than one boiler with that into that condensing economizer. So if you have a three boiler operation and you keep switching around the load, it still goes into condensing economizer. No matter which boiler you use, it still recovers the energy. It's a little more expensive because it's corrosion resistant. It has a separate stack typically. It's made out of plastic polycarbonate material rather than the steel, so it doesn't rust. But it recovers latent as well as the sensible heat, and that's the key to this application. So now, if you have typical feed water economizer, let's say, application, and you want to add condensing economizer on top of it, you can take the exhaust that would otherwise go up your stack, put it through the condensing economizer on the side, and now that allows you to put the makeup water directly. You don't have to do feed water. You can use cold makeup water, and you can reduce your exhaust gases even less temperature. However, to me, the biggest advantage of condensing economizer allows you to run the process water. For lots of people, process water is significant load, and this allows you to run process water all day long through that condensing economizer. Now, personally, I put there 60 degrees F, and there's an asterisk there in the slides. It'll say something about that as well. I would never run that at 60 degrees F. I find that to be a little too low. Yes, it recovers all the heat, but it's a little bit too low, and what you can get is almost your own weather system up on top of the roof. So I would probably keep that 90 to 100 degrees just to avoid some of the issues. But that's still significant savings. So as a result, condensing economizer can use process water, and it saves about 10% of the boiler energy on its own when used with feed water economizer. What I did do in a couple of applications is If the customer didn't have feed water economizer, I would say forget about feed water economizer, like just put condensing economizer on the side, and then we recovered 15% energy in that condensing economizer for the right application. So you don't have to have both if you don't want to. So we can do some simple testing. We can go and do a boiler flue gas measurement for you if you want. We can develop boiler heat and mass balance for you. Or we can connect you to any reputable third-party suppliers of the boilers and economizer if you want. It's one of the services that we've been offering for probably the longest, and we're very good at it. So please feel free to contact us for your application. In the last exercise of the day, so last opportunity to learn a bag of, to earn a bag of goodies today, is going to be, let's do a simple feed water economizer calculation. We'll have the flue gas temperature before economizer at 450, which is fairly standard, 320 after the economizers. Ambient temperature is 70 degrees, and in this case, that's important because all the calculations on the boiler are stack temperature minus ambient temperature, so it's the differential that matters. We have 5% excess oxygen measured on a 4.6 million BTU per hour boiler that operates 4,500 hours per year. There's a sketch of it. This is how it works. These are formulas that you will find in your workbook. And this is an excerpt from the combustion efficiency tables that you will need to use. So on the top row, you will have to find from 200 to 380 where your temperature delta temperature is, so stack minus ambient in both cases. On the left-hand column, you have oxygen level. Ours is 5%. And that will give us where the efficiency is, somewhere in this row, for in front of the economizer and after the economizer. So these are the calculations. These are the numbers that we're supposed to get to. The purpose of the exercise wasn't so much to find the exact number that it's going to be, because that's going to depend on your particular application, but just the logic of it, just to see how to get about figuring out what is it worth. Is it worth my effort? Going back to my original point, how do you know if it's worth my effort to even look at that? Because lots of people will just put air curtain and think they saved huge amounts of energy. In the meantime, they saved like 1,000 cubic meters. But they can save hundreds of thousands of running their equipment properly. So for the small feed water boilers, paybacks are about 2 to 3 years on a simple basis. And if you have heated water of any sorts that is constant and a good flow, condensing economizer offers much higher savings. And you will see an example of a real life project that we've done with one of those later on. Ways that you can influence the energy in your facility. Exhaust types and volumes, makeup air volumes, indoor temperature setting controls. If there is nobody in the place, maybe you can use setback temperatures. On the process side, do you control your process good? Do you have set point control well within your needs? Idling, if you idle something, do you shut down the process? I've had the facilities where they thought of to save, for example, electrical energy. When their process, for whatever reason, is interrupted, they're shutting down all the conveyors in the facility. And they saved huge amounts of electrical energy because conveyors don't need to run at that time. Waste heat recovery through the boiler economizer or some other way. And preventative maintenance. Preventative maintenance is actually a very important thing to do. If you maintain your equipment properly, it will run properly. I know that sounds very intuitive, but it's not always done that way. This is what we see often in our travels around our service territory. Analysis paralysis. Everybody looks at that and says, I don't know if I can handle this exhaust change or change to the process. It looks such a daunting task that nobody's even starting them. Another one, we don't have money for implementation. We don't want to upset the employees. This is very often when we deal with the exhaust. Nobody wants to upset the employees. And then ultimately, effort to get it approved, the project approved, is just too much for us to deal with on a regular basis based on everything else that we have to do. And I was guilty of the same thing when I was in the facility, because what you're judged on is the productivity levels, your quality control, and your health and safety. That's what you judge on. Nobody judges you on how many kilowatt hours you used for the product today versus yesterday. So of course, these things get put onto the back burner. But the problem is that business environment seems to change a little bit. Slowly, but it's changing. In today's environment, can we do nothing anymore? Is that an option? There's a cost of carbon that's now starting to be obvious. There's a business advantage to being green. It's a big advantage if you can say, I make the product the greenest possible. Customer requirements to minimize. So for example, if you sell to somebody who wants to minimize their manufacturing costs, they will transfer those to you. They will want to have minimized energy intensity to their product. People like Walmart, people like end users, they will want to have the green products on their shelves. So they will want you to prove that you're making the greenest. So all that brings extra scrutiny onto our facilities. All of that brings attention to the energy efficiency. For example, this is not part of the slides, but people often tell me how much energy do I use and where do I meter stuff. And we had a workshop, I think it was last workshop or the one before that, and it's posted on the internet. You can find a workshop on just metering, where to put, how to choose where to put metering, and our role in that. We can help you out with the financial incentives, up to 50% of the cost of the meter, up to certain maximum. And we can help you with the advice, what kind of meter to put and where. A lot of people don't submeter gas, it's because it's expensive exercise. Usually they think you have to cut into the pipe. Once you cut into the pipe, you have to put a spool meter. Once you put the spool meter, you have to put the bypass, because if the meter fails, you don't want your equipment to be without anything. So you have to put the bypass. But nowadays, depending on the pipe size you're dealing with, you can put insertion meters that cost less than the bypass itself. And we will give you 50% of that cost. If you don't have very complex requirements, if you have, for example, only need to monitor your meter of the facility, our Enbridge meter in front of your facility, we can give you 50% of the project cost to get information from that meter into your SCADA system. Its cost is about $1,700, $2,000 per meter, and we'll give you half of that, and you will have real live data of what you use in that facility. So there's ways of doing that, and if you're interested in metering and how to submeter some of your processes, let us know. The other way that people always forget is you don't have to meter energy necessarily directly. If you know your process, if we have inputs, we can possibly calculate how your process uses energy. And then as the setting parameters change, we can show how the energy is changing. So you don't necessarily need to submeter it. So last piece of this exercise is 3 R's. Just to give you some examples of how these 3 R's have been implemented at some of our customer sites. So reduce, recover, replace. And we'll start with the reduce. That is underutilized strategy, in my opinion, in our service territory. And it always fights that we have always done it this way syndrome. Nobody wants to change anything because somebody had set it up and somehow they think that's a given setting and that if anything changes, they would go straight into liquidation, which is not the case. On the other side, all those reduction opportunities are usually no cost or very low cost. It's what they call low-hanging fruit. They're easily reversible, so risk is actually quite low. Changing the setting on the oven, if you know what your previous setting is and it worked and you want to change it a little bit, change it for an hour or two, see what happens. If you don't like it, change it back. Cost you nothing. So why not explore the potential of that? A couple of our customers did. Exhaust reduction project. These are the numbers from the real life project that we've done a couple of years ago. For a total investment of $44,000 in audit, design, and install of simple exhaust control and makeup air control system. I avoid using the word building automation system because it's not true building automation. They controlled what they needed to control. They saved almost 800,000 cubic meters of gas and 1.2 megawatts of electricity. This is a small facility. They actually use 400,000 cubic meters of gas. And they used to have about 20, 30,000 CFM of makeup air. They used, I believe the number was closer to 500, 350,000 CFM of exhaust, Slova. So 350,000 versus, I believe it was 70,000 CFM of makeup air. So that's the scale. And of course, what they wanted to do originally, they wanted to add makeup air to balance their building. So they would go from 70,000 to close to 210,000, 220,000 CFM of makeup air. They still wouldn't be fully balanced, but they would be much closer. They would also use 800,000 cubic meters of natural gas doing that. And remember, this facility that uses 400,000 now. So they would add twice that to their usage. That was their solution. And the problem, underlying problem, was their facility was cold. So the people walked out in the middle of the winter because the facility was cold. Luckily, we got involved at the right time. We said, no, let's do air balance. Let's do air quality control. We did that. And even though the person, maintenance manager there, who was very vocal against reducing exhaust because they need it, they absolutely have to have these air changes, was the first one who was convinced by the air audit that they don't actually need it. So they reduced down the air exhaust to about 150,000, 175,000 CFM, I believe. And then the rest of that exhaust and the makeup air, they actually tied to their processes. So when the process doesn't run, makeup air doesn't run, exhaust doesn't run. Those are the savings. This is the simple payback. And this is not the only facility that has that. This is not uncommon. Most of your facilities, if you actually look at it, pharma excluded, is run like that. In today's environment, they saved or offset almost 1,500 tons of CO2. So significant savings for $40,000, $45,000 investment. The maintenance manager actually built his own system. So he didn't go out and bought a new building automation system. He controls it through the PLC. He's got a little user interface, very simple, and it works beautifully. So that's on the reduction, pure reduction, nothing else. Now recovery. Recover of the waste heat always somehow ends up being very this complex, over-engineered thing. Everybody thinks they have to have the best heat exchanger in the world. They have to recover every BTU available, but it's free. You're already wasting it. If you recover 50% of it, you're 50% further than you were last year. So it doesn't have to be this engineered process always. Sometimes it makes sense. Sometimes it doesn't. It can be just simple, just get the hot air into the other part of the plant. Payback of around 2 years, year, is not uncommon for these kind of applications. So it's not a complex solution. And basically what you want to do, for example, in the building air, you know that you have makeup air that you pay money to run. So it takes the cold air, heats it up, dumps the air into the building. You pay for that energy to pull the air, to heat it, and to dump it into the building. At the same time, you have electricity users in the building that you pay a lot more because electricity is more expensive, bad electricity. So you have this electricity users. And what do? They convert most of their energy into heat. Air compressors. 90% of the power that you put into the air compressor is offset as a heat, not to compress the air, as heat. So you have 100 horsepower compressor will actually put 90 horsepower of that 100 into the building as heat. And what do you typically do with that air compressor? You put it into a small room on the side, you close it off, it's really hot in there, you don't know exactly why, so you exhaust it. And then you pay for energy right next door, right on the other side of the wall to heat up that space. So why wouldn't we take that energy, put it to either preheat some of that air, So you have those glycol loops in the makeup air that preheats the air before it goes into the burner. Or even simpler, why wouldn't you just have like fans or something and could and distribute that hot air where you need it in the facility? That's recovery, that's waste heat recovery. And when we talk about waste heat, because it's waste, it doesn't mean that it's free. You paid for every one of those BTUs. You just don't get to use it where you intend to use it. So actual air compressor project. This is air-cooled air compressor. So $7,000 of design and install of the ducting. They took the air, you know how you have a hood above your air compressor typically that ducts conveniently air, hot air outside of the building? Well, they added to that, they put a damper, and they added another duct that goes inside the building. So in the winter time, that hot air gets put inside the building where it's needed and offsets some of their heating cost. In the summertime, damper closes, and it puts the hot air outside where it belongs. Now you can go a little bit for another maybe $3,000 to $5,000, you can be really fancy and have the temperature control damper. So to fight Jim's earlier point about how the weather changes nowadays very often, you have that temperature control so you don't have to worry where the compressor is. The temperature control itself tells compressor where to put the air. So they done $7,000 investment, they saved about $8,500. 30,000 cubic meters of natural gas was saved just by dumping that air into the building where it belongs in the wintertime. We provided incentive, it's a half a year payback. And they saved 55 tons of CO2, which is not bad for one duct. Water-cooled air compressor can be used in the same way. What these guys have done, they had a very big air compressor, I believe it was 300 horsepower. Happened to be very close to the boiler room. So what was happening is they had an air compressor that had waste heat. The water cooling that they used for cooling of the compressor went out to the cooling tower. Right next to it was another pipe that went to feed water into the boiler, make up water to the boiler. So what we did is we put heat exchanger in between. We took the heat from the water cooling loop from the air compressor to preheat the makeup water for the boiler. And because the air compressor runs all the time, it's a big air compressor, what they recovered is 230,000 cubic meters of natural gas in their boilers by doing this. Heat exchanger cost them $21,000. It wasn't very sophisticated. They actually took it out of their stores because they had something that looked about the right size. They just checked for the pressure, that the pressure is okay in the heat exchanger. So they didn't really design it. They put the sensors for the measuring of the temperature in and out to know that it works. And these are the savings. $21,000 saved them $65,000. $65,000 annually. Payback, 0.4 years. Waste heat recovery with a payback way less than a year. Saves 430 tons of CO2 in today's emissions. Another redistribution project. We talked about that before, but $38,000 investment with audit, design, and install allowed them to put socks, which is like a duct made out of almost like a cloth-like material. They put the socks along their roof from their injection area, so plastic injection molding machines, you know how hot they get. And they had a whole bunch of exhaust right above them, about 85,000 CFM worth of the exhaust. And that exhaust was running at about 30 degrees Celsius out of the building. So they put socks that took that air, they shut down these exhausts in the wintertime, and they took the socks that had the small fans on the entrance of them, and they took that air about 100 feet away into their shipping area, and they dumped it there. They shut off all of unit heaters in that place, every single one of them. For $38,000, $39,000, $57,000 payback. Again, 379 tons of CO2. Nothing engineered. Sock that looked roughly the same. The fan that was rated roughly the same where the fans were rated on the roof, so we know that the flow is the same. We measured the temperature above the machines, and we measured the temperature in the shipping area before and after. They shut down all their unit heaters, and what happens is that is the season that the employees said that they were never as comfortable in the winter as they were that year. So it doesn't have to be complicated. Take the air from where you don't need it, the hot air, push it where you need it. This one was a little more complex. Same idea. Injection molding machines. This time they had a warehouse just behind the wall. So if this was injection molding area, there would be a wall, there would be a big warehouse on the other side. These guys wanted to have even distribution in the warehouse for their needs in the warehouse of the air. So they actually put 14 fans along the wall, all along the wall, that took the air from this room and dumped it into the warehouse area. 14 fans. That's why the cost is about $105,000. And the payback was still below 2 years. So they saved about 154,000 cubic meters, 289 tons of CO2. Very expensive, relatively speaking, when we compare it to the other projects that I showed you. Yet it still pays back 1.7 years. And they still save energy. The other way to recover is what we talked about. You have two different sources of heat, two different exhaust points in the facility. So you would take some of the money that you put into your input, and you would dump it out the exhaust. And you would do that on the other one as well, because exhaust costs you money. Why not take some of the exhaust, put that energy to preheat whatever you're doing in the other process that reduces your exhaust losses on the first equipment, which means you pay less that goes up the roof, and you reduce your input cost into this other equipment. So not only you improve your efficiency, you're lowering your costs. Typical example, condenser economizer projects. I said earlier that I'm going to give you an example of it. New condenser economizer piping install, $276,000, give or take. Not cheap. But look at the savings. 657,000 cubic meters of natural gas. They added a little bit of electricity, because they need a fan to take the air, exhaust flue gas from one stack to another, but not bad. Total savings are still $162,000. And with our incentive, it was 1.1 year payback. 1.1 year payback on almost more than a quarter million dollar project. And that reduced their cost enough that they actually got more business, because now they're more competitive in Ontario. So that kind of project works. And these are the guys that actually, we took the condensing economizer, we put it on top of their stack, and we completely eliminated their direct contact water heater. Now, lots of people would say direct contact water heater is the most efficient way to heat water. Yes, if your water is once through. If you put your water, cold water, you heat it, you put it into process, you dump it, you start with the fresh water. Correct. That's not what they've done. They had a loop where the water was returning. Their direct contact water heater was running at about 50-55% efficient. And it was using almost as much gas as their boiler. So by using exhaust from the boiler, we eliminated this whole other source of energy use and reduced the energy by 650,000. That, by the way, is almost 10% of their overall usage of the site. And they're not light user. They saved 1,200 tons of CO2 in today's world. But you can do this on an oven exhaust as well. We talked about reducing the oven exhaust if you can. Some people are absolutely against it. They don't want to reduce anything. Fine. These guys did the same thing. They did actually two things. They reduced exhaust, but not as much as they were hoping for. But that was their own internal fight that they fought. They reduced it about 50% rather than 75% that they could. And then what they did, they put heat exchanger, air-to-air heat exchanger on the leftover exhaust. So once they did that, they essentially used the exhaust from the oven to preheat the air that the oven was using. So they constantly had this heat recovery cycle for their ovens. $30,000 investment, almost $30,000 savings a year. With our incentives, 0.7-year payback. It saved them about 100,000 cubic meters of natural gas. Just by putting heat exchanger, two VFDs, to control exhaust and the inlet into the oven. 184 tons of CO2. So the last part of this is the replacement. It's one of those things that people usually go to. It's simple, because it's simple to replace failed equipment. So sometimes we're referring to replacement or adding equipment to replace or add new functionality. Either or can be used sometimes interchangeably. But for us to fall under our program, the goal of the replacement has to be to gain some energy efficiency in the process. So if you do like for like, that's not part of the energy savings program. But unfortunately, replacing same unit with exactly identical one is the least risk. So if you're a maintenance manager and if you're judged only on your uptime, yeah, you want to put something you know that is going to run. And what do you know is going to run? The stuff that ran so far. The problem with that is that non-energy benefits, simple installation, no risk, outweigh any of the energy benefits sometimes. People just don't want to risk it. The problem that you're not solving sometimes is the underlying problem why the equipment failed or needed to be replaced or some added functionality needed to be added. Just like those exhausts, putting new makeup air is maybe, okay, that's a replacement, we'll add makeup air, but it's not going to resolve your underlying problem necessarily. So what are potential downsides if you do it that way? Well, simple one is opportunity to improve your facility has been missed. You spend the money, you're not gonna get that money for that unit for another 15 years until it fails again. Funds that you did spend into that thing could have been spent better somewhere else. I see this all the time. People do air curtains, people do dock seals, and they will spend $10,000 on a D-strat fan that will save them nothing. They could have spent $10,000 on controlling their exhaust and actually solved their problem. So we're not asking people to spend more, we're just asking them to think about it, how to spend it better and smarter. Cost of ownership might actually increase. So yes, your unit might be cheaper, but if you bought a better unit, over the life of the unit, you would save more. And of course, credibility of energy efficiency initiatives is badly affected. If you say, I'm gonna save something and I'm installing the D-strat fan, and nobody ever sees the savings, how many people will give you money later to do yet another idea that didn't save anything first time around? So you have to be careful with that. So to ensure success, what we really have to look at, we have to understand where the energy savings are going to come from. So if the vendor comes and sells you the latest and greatest, you want to know what is the mechanism that energy is being saved by. And if we can't describe to you in a simple way, get their technical support to describe to you. If they can describe to you, maybe there is nothing there. Call us, we'll tell you what our opinion is. Ensure you have a method to verify the savings. I spent about, probably in my life, probably $20 million on buying different equipment. And I can tell you that every single time I bought a piece of equipment, I had to verify that it works the way I wanted it to work. I bought robots that for transferring coils, I needed to ensure that they work every 3.8 seconds. Better believe it that I was waiting there with a watch clock to ensure that that works, even before I installed it. But most of us will actually buy any piece of makeup air or anything else that touches energy without any strings attached. You will go back to the manufacturer, you will say, guarantee me this, and they will say, oh, that depends on many factors, I can't guarantee you anything. If they can't guarantee you anything, then probably they can't guarantee you the savings either that they're promising you. So make sure you have the method to verify the savings, if the reason to buy the unit were the savings in the first place. And create a scope of work incorporating that methodology. How are you gonna measure those savings? If somebody tells you, I'm gonna achieve 80% efficiency, how are we gonna measure it? Put it into the scope of work. you do it for every other piece of equipment you do. So one of the things that I have seen over and over again, that nobody follows basic business case practices in energy field for whatever reason. We buy ovens, we want to make sure that we have plan, do, check, act in place. We want to make sure that you define the benefits, how much this is going to cost me, what I'm going to get in the return, what's the cost of ownership. But we don't do that for anything energy related. Zero. We trust them. They told us they're going to be better. Based on what? And we have to remember that every time we go and ask for somebody for money, they want to see the benefits. If they don't see the benefits, next time you go and ask for money, it'll be much harder to get that money. That's human nature. That's how it works. So there's no reason. If somebody just tells you, buy this unit because it's good, okay, fine. Buy it because it's good. If somebody tells you, buy this unit because it's going to save you 30% of energy, you better ask where that 30% is coming from. 30% of what in the first place? I have been in places where these strat fans are going to save 30% of energy. 30% of which energy? Well, of energy. Of the whole place? Well, no, this little piece. What's 30%? What goes into that little piece? So how can you know what you're saving if you don't know what you're using in the first place? So you do this for every other piece of equipment. There is no reason not to do it for energy. None. And in summary, what we really want to do with our program, what my seven ESCs and myself are really trying to get you to do, is we want you to get from managing energy costs, because you're still using the same amount of energy, it just costs you a little bit less. We want you to get out of that and manage the energy itself. And that reduces the cost and the amount of energy you use. And what happens in today's world, you actually reduce your emissions. No matter how cheap you buy your natural gas, it does not change how much emissions it creates. So what we really want you to get to is to get to the point where you base your decision on what to purchase on some sort of knowledge. You are sure of this, this is why I'm doing it. Then those actions, those decisions will turn into actions, and those actions will turn into savings. Without actions, there is no savings. And we want those actions to be based on both knowledge and the confidence that you have in the numbers that you were given. So we looked at seven projects that are listed there. Average cost of those projects was $74,000, let's call it. And average annual savings, I discounted them by 15%, just in case there is something going off, if we didn't have some assumption, right? Let's say your savings were discounted by 15%. That still gives IRR of 113% over 5 years. There's nothing else that gives that return. No investment. And to help with that, we give $21,000 on average for those seven projects. So when you talk energy efficiency to your guys in the accounting area, these are the numbers they want to see. They don't care what you saved in the BTUs or in kilowatt hours or in gigajoules. This is the number they want to know. So if you need help to present that to your management, just let us know. We'll help you out with that. And that's it. That wraps it up. Thank you very much for your time, and thank you for being here.